thanks. Hi, of the audience and the group here. How many of you are familiar with SharePoint 2010? Okay. And installed it? Okay. And meaning I assume that you work with Visual Studio Web Parts and other components to build for SharePoint. All right. And how many of you are familiar with the Windows Azure platform? Much lesser hands. Okay, I can count 4, 5. All right, how many of you are familiar with Windows Azure, know what it is, what are the various components, probably not. Okay, again. So is it a fair assumption to say that let's take a quick overview of the cloud and then see how it can be or why it needs to be integrated with SharePoint? Will that work? Yeah? So please stop me at points where you think it's not going fine. If you're going to discuss that, we'll park it for later. Otherwise, we'll take it then and there. It's a small group, so it might as well be a conversation. All right. So today's agenda, 50 minutes, pretty short to cover this expansive topic. So I think it'll be more like giving guidance and pointers as to these are what is available and these are what you can go back and look out for. And these are what is possible as of today with the cloud, which is maturing on a day-to-day manner. So we will first see where we are. We will see what is Windows Azure, the cloud, so-called. On a personal note, I would say it's a little precarious to call it the operating system on the cloud. But Windows Azure definitely provides operating system services on the cloud. All right. So we will talk a little bit about what has Microsoft Cloud got to offer. And then we will say that where is SharePoint heading to, meaning how important it is in enterprise and even outside enterprise as we go along today. And we'll say what is the synergy between the two. And finally, see on technical grassroots level, what are the possibilities of integration of these two technologies. Couple of pointers from the product group and the teams which are working on it. And you can go back and do a bunch of wonderful, interesting weekend projects on the same. Sounds interesting?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay. So getting started. A few specifics I thought just to give you pointers, drop in here and there about the cloud, fairly new group on the cloud. So is it cloud? Many of you will have your own doubts whether cloud is the way that is being headed to. Is it really a disruptive technology? For me, I would say it's more of an evolution rather than a revolution. It's been there for a long time, right from the web services days, and it's evolving over time and becoming bigger chunk here. And so we call those business services or those web services maturing into software, now maturing into a business logic, and now maturing into an entire platform, and we are consuming it on the wire over HTTP, and we choose to call it cloud as of today. Going by that, says that many companies, Fortune 1000 companies, enterprises are heading towards cloud. Gartner report says the same. Also says that by analysis, if you see the enterprise companies which are working, about 53% of the cost is spent on infrastructure, which and platform as a service. Okay, these are more like jargons, as you see, but it really means that on-premise is a very classic scenario that you all have, where you are total sole system admins of your entire distributed system that you might be managing. You have your private setup of your application. I could call that as a cloud, and I could call that as a private cloud if I'm hosting somebody else's applications on this and giving it out through an HTTP URL, right? So it's a very subjective terminology when we use the word cloud. But essentially, as a customer or as a person who has a company, for example, if I make my trip.com, then if I have all my servers on my premise and I have somebody to manage, do the patch updates, disaster recovery, failover, cluster, all that, they can take care of all that, then I say I have an on-premise setup. Moving more, if I feel that I just don't want to invest capital expenditure and cost on all this, but I still have the manpower and the IP, the intellect to handle all of these, but I don't have the infrastructure, then I can go and remote TS to a bunch of other services which is provided by a lot of companies, including Amazon EC2. Microsoft is coming up with the VM role, which will just provide a virtual machine for you. You are a system admin on that machine and you're free to do what you want. One step more, what is now being called as platform as a service is really to say we take care of more things away from you. First was capital expenditure, the hardware cost, etc. Second is you don't even need to do patch upgrades. You don't need to do the classic system admin tasks of backup, recovery, failover. All those are taken care of. Instead, you focus on being a developer. So more of an IT pro job is taken care by the automated system, and the developers are free to use that platform and build applications and deploy the applications. In that way, I would call that as platform as a service. Now, Microsoft and the meat of today's talk will be on platform as a service, because Microsoft's cloud offering, which is the Windows Azure platform, provides platform as a service. Coming slides, you will see that it says that it's operating system on the cloud. Again, as I said, don't understand it to be a GUI-based operating system on the cloud. It's primarily providing a platform access for developers to build applications. For example, as an operating system, you might need a couple of very basic things. You send abc.exe, it needs to execute it. Be it a front-end or HTTP web-based application, or a back-end huge grid computing or a background data crunching operation. So you're giving an application, it should be able to process or host that application. So if a platform is able to do that, gives you APIs for developers to build that, then that could probably be called as platform as a service. Right? I'm just differentiating all of these. Now, similarly, other operating system tasks like storage helps you for messaging, symbol tables. You need basic data structures, flat storages. Those are something mandatory for any operating system. Can I get that on the wire? Is there some storage, some data structures on the cloud which I can use? Then, as a developer, I can take advantage of that. Then I would call that as a platform as a service, because the platform is giving me that service. Right? I'm just differentiating. Similarly, that platform inherently takes care of scheduling, managing, disaster recovery, as I said. So that does the third most important part of an operating system, which does the main heart of operating system, managing the resources, hardware, and the application's health. So that is being done. And finally, for developers, it gives you a easy interface. Be .NET developers, you have a breeze on Visual Studio on the cloud, or be outside .NET developers, direct handlers out of Eclipse for Java developers, and REST-based access, handlers and drivers for Ruby and Rails. So it's a completely open platform. REST-based platform is Windows Azure. I'm actually jumping slides because I'm just setting context so that we can go into the other details. Finally, SaaS is software as an application, software as a service, which is to say that the end product, make my trip hosted on an ISP or hosted on some outside their enterprise, will say that we have built a SaaS version of Make My Trip, which is accessible on the cloud for everybody. Is the distinction clear? Yeah? Any questions? Okay, so we pretty much saw this, also discussed this, which is Windows Azure platform is the centerpiece that you see, which provides platform as a service. From Microsoft, software as a service, that is ready-made softwares are available which you can consume. The entire Office suite of products, that is PowerPoint, Office, Excel, everything is available on the wire. So that is a classic example from the Microsoft product stack. SharePoint Online is available. Only, I think, 2007 is available. 2010 is not yet available on the cloud. So those are direct softwares on the cloud. Platform as a service is more interesting and more useful for developers, because they can build their scenarios, they can build softwares, and then expose it as SaaS for other end customers. So you see two names here, Windows Azure, SQL Azure. Very intuitive. SQL Azure is for, you know, is a counterpart for your on-premise SQL Server, which is a database on the cloud, which has a relational database management system. Windows Azure is more operating system capabilities on the cloud. As I said, you can host your applications, you can get multiple storages, although those storages are not relational. They'll be flat storages, much, much less expensive. And then you have service management and APIs and handlers. Now, this being said, the various components currently as of today on the Windows Azure platform stack is what you see here. It has compute components to host your application, storage, management, CDN is available. The App Fabric part is also maturing and is multiple. The previous session, how many of you were there for the previous session? So that was a dedicated app fabric session. So, and then the marketplace is another very interesting component which has been integrated with SharePoint in multiple scenarios. So Windows Azure Marketplace is was codenamed as Dallas. You can go to datamarket.azure.com. That will be your URL to access the Dallas. It's free. You can go get an account subscription key and then subscribe for multiple data feeds. So basically, the crime branch of US, the NASA Institute of US, multiple other companies, they can choose to make it paid or free. So once they put the data there, that data is available in multiple feed formats, OData, JSON, REST-based, etc. So your application, be it an Azure cloud application, on-premise application, mobile application, any kind of application, including SharePoint, right? Because SharePoint can also access, now with 2010, can access REST-based feeds. So you can then integrate those data into your SharePoint portal and create, overlay it over Bing Maps and create visual effects, etc. So that's an interesting point. You can even subscribe to the feeds, as I said, or you can even be a content provider, provide your feeds based on your requisites, etc. SQL Azure currently has the basic data sync and the database components. Reporting services already on the cloud, currently in beta phase. So various other analytics, other things will, which is counterparts of the SQL Server 2008 R2 will now be available one by one on the cloud. So now getting on to today's session, which is why really SharePoint and Azure. So if you see, SharePoint is an enterprise collaboration platform, which is now being available for exposing over intranet, internet components, which has multiple social networking components, tags, various new features with 2010, right? So they also realized that on enterprise, when multiple components of the enterprise, as we saw in the previous slides, are already on the cloud, your SharePoint should be able to consume or push data, that is two-way synchronization, onto the cloud. Multiple for three main, they've bucketed more like a marketing slide, I should say, which says that it's for reach, resource, and reusability of your code. How do you set up your environment and what is needed to get started? Now, most of you on the SharePoint front will be familiar with SharePoint installations and setting up with SharePoint. Easiest way for all newcomers will be to download the virtual machine, which is available with 180 days trials. So all you do is on the left hand side, you just download the VM, and the right hand side, all the components are free. So you can just go and install the SDK. The Windows Azure components, the main thing that you need is to install the SDK and tools for Visual Studio if you're a .NET developer. How many of you .NET developers here? How many of you are non-.NET developers here? I think that's a better way to. Okay, so this session might be a little .NET oriented because that's more easy, faster, and easier integration to SharePoint, but we can take the other questions offline as well. So the Express editions of Visual Studio and SQL Server work fantastically with the cloud, which means that you can download the whole thing on the right free and get started now. What comes with the Windows Azure SDK is a simulation also of the real cloud on your desktop. If time permits, we can just probably take a quick look at the simulation, which makes it really useful and easy for all developers, because once you deploy applications on the cloud, one, you're charged, so you have to think about paying. You understand the pay by as you use model, right, of the cloud? Yes? Yeah? So if you're hosting your application on the cloud, really, you have to pay for the time you use. You can choose components like extra small, small, medium, large virtual machines, such as that. On the other hand, if there is a simulation on your desktop, it makes it so much easier for you to build, run, iterate, do debugging, and all those components with Visual Studio step in and step over support. So that's part. Now let's quickly take a look at Windows Azure Cloud and SharePoint also. So the Windows Azure portal, which I've tried to open up here, This is what the Windows Azure portal looks like. This is a new portal. You have to sign in with a live ID. So, and you need to, currently for all developers, the real portal also is free. You have certain amount of hours available per month for you to try and test. But you might need to give your credit card just to be sure. But they'll keep sending reminders, so that is there. And then there are these various components that you see on the bottom left. Hosted services, storage is a fundamental operation wherein you can go create a new hosted service and deploy or web application or background applications on the cloud. Accordingly, there are two kind of roles on the cloud. One is for web role, which is for web applications. Background processes are called worker roles or worker applications. You have two options. You can deploy it on the staging environment and then upgrade it to the production. So you know there is a test and dev environment on the cloud for you. You can whip swap them also, just DNS swap entries, so that it makes the upgradation so much easier. Because of net connection and issues that you see here, you might not be able to see multiple things that I'm talking about. That's pretty much why I'm keeping it more vocal session. But if it works, we can see that you will have options of you can go and connect to remote desktop to that virtual machine which is actually hosting your application. So you can go into that virtual machine, check the gap, do some silent upgrade. Anything that you want is available now. For all of these, of course, you have to add certificate authentication and any extra other security that you want is over and above what is available on the platform. Similarly, the database, let's see if this opens up. Just as SSMS, you have, it was codenamed as Houston, Project Houston on the cloud, which is SSMS on the cloud, which is available. Once it opens, this manage icon that you see here will open up an online portal where you can write your T-SQL queries, you can do SPs, you can segregate, you can visualize data off the cloud directly online. This doesn't mean that you cannot connect it offline. I could connect to my SQL Azure cloud from my SSMS right here by giving it a particular server instance name. And also, it supports only SQL authentication. ADFS is not yet supported, will be available soon. So once I say connect, if you have a decent bandwidth, it should connect in some time. Of course, the issue with the cloud is, at least in India, we are still heavily bandwidth dependent. That makes more scenarios which are hybrid, that is having an offline sync, having a small software which is going to asynchronously sync your data online, that is being more. That's when the sync frameworks comes into picture. In most of the scenarios that you see which are deployed or live scenarios with the cloud, there is a sync framework always involved just to have a backup synchronization at the end. So this will connect to SSMS ideally. Let's go back and see what else we have on the portal. Reporting, I said, is as CTP. You have to request for it and will be given in batches. Service bus, access control, these are the app fabric components. For those of you who weren't there for the last session, quick thing about the app fabric components is the BizTalk services, which was there and which soon died out slowly, which is connecting across NATs and firewalls and enabling those various scenarios where multicast, end-to-end, pub-sub models of connection are brought in by the service bus components. You have to have certain ports open, but you can write your code to create these scenarios. Access control service is more like a claims-based authentication component, which says that basically this is a claims engine, so you can use it as a reference in your application to say that if I get a claim from access control service is called ACS as a short form. If I get a claim from ACS, I know that it has authenticated and authorized to this role or this level. So that you can set up in ACS and then you can use that in your software or your application. So these are some of the components. Point that I wanted to show was the hosted service, which apparently is taking time. Let's go back and now for those of you, your sweet playground is your SharePoint portal. So let's go and open up the SharePoint 2010. How many of you are seeing it for the first time? Okay, SharePoint, this is the new SharePoint 2010. Silverlight based UI in many sense. You can go to site actions and when we go ahead and create multiple sites, you get these jazzy UI effects. You have out of the box media player controls, you have out of the box Silverlight controls, you have lot of new things, which includes, which is pertinent to us today, is the client object model for Silverlight. So you have the entire SharePoint data or object model exposed for .NET, for Silverlight, for JavaScript, which we can use when we code against Azure also. So these are some of the UIFX. It's taking a lot of time because I have installed SharePoint as a sandbox solution. Now with SharePoint 2010, another thing is there is a concept of sandbox solutions where you can deploy it on your dev environment, and then it's a standalone machine and you can do all your development there. Once you create your WSP, you can port it to the farm. That is possible from here. Also, it's 4 GB RAM. Recommended is 6 or 8. Purposely, we kept it on 4, so that makes it much slower but doesn't crash the system as such. So while that is also loading, here is my data market, which I told you, just kept that open. This is your datamarket.azure.com, which is the Dallas data market. There is a lot of data available here. You can go and subscribe to these fields, the output of which will be you will get an account ID. Using that account ID is basically a GUID, which you can use in your code to access these data. So what are the various methods or what are the various integration points from SharePoint and Azure? One is straightforward. Many of you already use it to integrate various other components, Java applets into SharePoint, directly have an iframe and give your HTTP URL on that iframe, and then that gets exposed into your SharePoint portal. Straightforward, simple approach, but very easy. It has its own pros and cons as well. Another option is hosted data, where you saw the Dallas data, SQL Azure database. So the data is available. Now what you do from your SharePoint is you basically create an ECT, that is external content type, and then you, using BCS, you're pulling in that external data, which you would do even otherwise. If you have an XML feed, any feed you can do using ECT. Similarly, even the SQL Azure or any other on-the-cloud data can be pulled in and displayed as lists. So this is another way of integration. Also pretty easy, pretty straightforward, and very useful, which is also done in a lot of Dallas integrations. Now the third and the most powerful is the custom integration, wherein what you typically say is this will enable two-way integration between your Azure and SharePoint. What essentially happens, just try to visualize, Azure is on the cloud, and Azure can, by Azure I mean the hosting component of the Azure platform where you can host your application or service or whatever be it. Now that service can be of multiple types, as I said. I said it can be front-end like a web role, HTTP based component, can be back-end. So essentially in the Microsoft data centers, which are like thousands of computers which have been stacked together, which have been created into one data center component, run at the rock bottom, Windows Server 2008 R2 ripdown version without GUI, and they have .NET 4.0 and IIS 7.5. So typically any application that is compliant with these configurations, if you deploy it on the cloud, it works. Things like, for example, MVC3, which was not yet supported on the cloud, meaning the Razer DLL was not available on the Windows Azure. So in that cases, what do? You have the flexibility of going ahead and installing these DLLs manually. Manually you can install it, or through the code you can install it. What do I mean by it? For example, I can go and let's see if I have any. Let me open up Visual Studio just to make sense of what I'm saying. Many of these integrations, due to the internet constraint, will not probably work fully, but we'll see when I'm creating a new project. Now, as I told you, we had to install the Windows Azure SDK. Once you install that, I get this cloud
component on the template. And in fact, even if you don't, if you just have Visual Studio Express Edition, you can automatically here it will give you an option to say download the SDK from the internet, and it will enable that for you. So I can go create a Windows Azure project. It will give you multiple options of creating, multiple templates. You can create a blank and do everything grass up, but you can do something like a web role. You can do MVC2 is supported. I said MVC3 is not yet. So if you want to do MVC3, just supposing, you can do it because you have that control on the cloud. For example, in this case, let's go and create a WCF web role. That means you are hosting a WCF service on the cloud, which you can consume. Pretty much the same scenario, which will be used in a lot of cases in SharePoint. What SharePoint does is, there is a WCF service on the cloud, on the Azure, which you can call. So now the SharePoint is able to access this WCF service, just as you saw on the portal. Here, if you see, there are two components. One is your cloud application. How many of you are seeing it for the first time? So this is the cloud application, which is a very easy way to deploy an application to the cloud. It has something called roles. These roles are the projects which you want to include into the cloud. So you can, in a very legacy application, if you have a .NET based application with a couple of projects, you can go and integrate all of them into cloud and just do minor changes and tweaks to enable them onto the cloud. Although that might not be the best architectural consideration, but you can move it onto the cloud very straightforwardly from Visual Studio. Now the thing that you see on top is your classic WCF service project with just three changes actually. One is on the service reference, there are a couple of new DLLs, which is Azure-based DLLs. There are diagnostics for all the diagnostic data, trace listeners and other components. Service runtime is your basic heartbeat where you can go and say, now go ahead, increase the scale, increase the virtual machines to some extent, decrease it, tell me when the event is getting triggered, things like that. Storage client is the Windows Azure storage, which we did not talk today. We said that SQL Azure provides RDBMS storage. I said an operating system, ideally on the cloud, should provide certain storage data structures, which is there in the Windows Azure platform. And those storage components can be accessed using the storage client DLL. So that's part of that. And that's the first difference. The second one is your webrole.cs, which will go ahead and do a loop for forever true loop where you can go and do certain instance that you want to trigger some operations, etc. So it's basically a non-start event, and you can go ahead and say keep going down, and whenever there is an event, trigger it, or you can just completely ignore the same also. The web.config, the trace listeners for the diagnostics have been configured. So these are the three things that are added onto this service. Now when you come back to the cloud service here, once your development, everything is complete on your application, all you would typically need to do is build your application as you build normally. You could also do a multiple configuration changes here by going ahead and saying that I want the instance, that is, I want the virtual machine which is hosting to say I want 4, 5, how many ever virtual machines. Depending on the number you choose, you'll be paying for it. So basically, the number you write there is the number of virtual machines being allocated for you. And then there are multiple sizes for these virtual machines. You can set multiple web.config parameters. Various endpoints that you want to expose or talk from one internal endpoint to another endpoint. There is a scratchpad storage. If you're writing a chat client and you don't want to save a history kind of thing, off the record thing, and you just want it for that instance at that point of time, you can use some scratchpad. Maximum around 250 GB is available. Certificates, all these can be added from here. Finally, once you build your application, you can right click and say publish. When you say publish, it will ask you to connect you to an online credential. For me, I've already linked it to an online credential, so I'm able to see that on the Dropbox. If you're doing it for the first time, you would need to say add and go ahead and add your online credential. And then you can go and say, you can enable IntelliTrace. That means it will get the entire trace of all the operations that's happening for that virtual machine. If you deploy 4 virtual machines, there'll be 4 IntelliTraces traces. So you can historically debug it backwards if there is an error at any point of time. So those are some options. You can configure remote desktop. I said you can actually go and TS into that, but you have to do certificate management for this. So not digressing from today's session, I just wanted to give you a glimpse as to what this cloud looks like from Visual Studio. Now you host a WCF service, as I said, on the cloud. Now this diagram might make more sense, where your service is hosted on the cloud, which is available on the portal. Now your SharePoint is able to access this because it's open. It's also available on REST-based feeds, and you can put it onto various lists, and you can also push data which will be consumed by the cloud, vice versa. From the share, this is, in fact, this is one slide which will be a take-back slide from this session, really, to say what are the various integration points on the SharePoint system where you can use SharePoint and Azure integrate. Like I said, Silverlight is a very easy and standard component because both are extremely supportive of that. I said something like BCS, which is also available. COM objects, that is object model, is a standard which is done by various, many implementations have been done, which can be used directly using Visual Studio and the client object model to integrate SharePoint and the cloud. Link is coming up, and search is also coming up. So iframe, let's probably just quickly take a look at iframe integration if we have some internet issues. So I'm just going, opening my, let me go and create a new web part here. So I'm creating a web part and I'm trying to add my Azure component as an iframe into this web part. So while this is happening, I can probably just open up and see if my SQL Azure was able to connect. No. Connect it again. So that was one way to integrate. Let that open up. Simple, lightweight, no code, no deployment to SharePoint, etc. But there is a lot of constraint on the styling. It's not a very loose integration, not a deep integration, etc. So all you have to do is give your Azure URL link there on your iframe code, and that gets integrated automatically. Time permits, we'll see that. In the hosted component, I said if your data is from SQL Azure or Dallas or any data on the cloud, you can access it using BCS. So how do you go about and access that? You can do it on code side using Visual Studio, or you can do it using directly SharePoint Designer. Used SharePoint Designer 2010. Yeah. So that's basically a free tool. And in fact, it's very interesting story when it got free. It became free from April 2nd. They didn't want to make it free on April 1st because then people will not even believe that it is free. So from April 2, it was free. And from 2007 version or 2010 is available. And that has, you can create BCS, or that is business connectivity services from that, and also access the same. From the code part, we'll see if this is, so I have a, pardon me, for the interest of time, I'm just juggling between multiple demos and multiple technical pages. So I'm going and creating a web part page here. So in this web part page, I shall go and add an iframe. So that's one part of it. Let's just park it while this is getting, every time it's available, we'll go back and take a look at this. Now let me go and open up my SQL Azure project, which I have here. So this project that you see here is integrating using BCS and client object model from your .NET code and able to display a particular list on SharePoint. So let's create test web part. So if you see this, created a blank SharePoint project, and then I went and added a visual web part. Again, with SharePoint 2010, you can go and add a visual web part, right? So you can add a visual web part. And then I added an ASCX, that is a controller on that. Let me open up the controller and show you what has been coded in it. So I'm able to go and write my normal query string which I have written. I can go and create a particular data set. And finally, this is a main thing which enables me to connect to my SQL Azure. So this is the standard thing which you'll want to connect to your SQL server. You'll just have to change the connection string. That's all you would need to do. So when you change the connection string here, you have to give the connection string of your SQL Azure database that you saw, multi-passwords, the various components, and after which it's the standard code that you might write outside of Windows Azure coding also. Meaning I can go create an adapter, I can execute my command and then fill my data set and data bind it to a grid which I have already set up. All right. If you see here, this is my data structure path holder for that controller, and I'm adding that controller onto my page. Pretty straightforward to build and deploy. So I go build this solution, and then I could go and say deploy. And then it's automatically deployed onto my SharePoint portal. I can specify the portal components here. So if you go to the properties, I can go and say which URL I want to go and deploy it to. So particular URL, I can say this is my sandbox URL that I have. If you have a farm implementation, you have to set those appropriately. Once I say that, it's going to add the solution and deploy it onto the farm. Meanwhile, our iframe integration has come to a particular level. We can go and add a web part here. So I can go and say media and content web part. I can open a content editor and I go and add a web part. On this web part, I can say add new content. I can add directly edit the HTML source for the content, of which I can go and add my iframe code which we just saw right here. So let me go and quickly pick that up and add that here. Just going to change this to a hosted application which I have on my production environment, which you weren't able to see. But so this is, if the internet was fine, then this, you can automatically see that page here, and you can change only, you can do only so much in your formatting. It's not completely formattable. Ideally, your live page will be available right here. Okay. Similarly, for the SQL Azure integration, if you go and check here, it says deploy succeeded. So if you go back to my home page and say probably edit this page and then go to insert and add a web part. So I can choose, this becomes a wiki page automatically with SharePoint 2010. I can just go and access, put my cursor and say this is where I want to place my web part, and I go to custom web part this SQL Azure Visual Web Part has got deployed, the one which we deployed there. So now you can go and add this web part manually. Once the web part is added, you can, it says that this web part, and it says that get the stored data. This will be your SQL Azure data. Most likely this will also not work because we are not connected to the internet. The network connection is not great. So let's see. So when I say get the data here, should be able to get the SQL Azure data and display the data right here. So let me go back to home and say get the data. So you see the SQL Azure data which has got pulled up from the SQL Azure database. So it is very straightforward. We just had added that here, and then we are able to display a grid view from our .NET onto this. Now, this is a tight integration where you use .NET code using client object model to integrate. The iframe one which you just saw was the simple integration. Hopefully, we can just see the iframe component also. Let's go to, I think I added it in site assets. So you can go to let's go back. See if the this is your iframe integration which we did, and if the network is good, we will be able to see that page here. The third kind of thing is you use SharePoint Designer to connect and access your data. So now you see this is your iframe integration. Still, it's not loaded fully. I don't have controls to scroll. But this is a Zoller.com site, which is now available on the normal URL portal. It's a cloud cloudapp.net is the link that will all is the standard link. You can change it, map it to another DNS, but normally all cloud applications will end with cloudapp.net. So that's about that. Finally, I just wanted to quickly show you SharePoint Designer and say that how we can integrate SharePoint Designer onto this as well. So normal way that we do, we can go open external content type. We can say add a connection. In the add connection, we can say if you want to connect to SQL Azure, that is. Only these, otherwise you have to manually have a WCF service. You can host that service on Azure, on any other component and access the same. If you have SQL Server, you can say SQL Server and then say OK. And enter your SQL Server credentials. Very similar to the credentials that you entered right here. Okay, so once you enter these credentials, one thing that you would need to do is you need, because it's still not ADFS, you have to get that integration from your SharePoint to your SQL Server, right? So in your SharePoint management server, you would need to go to your, in the central admin, you will have to go and create your application ID. How do you go ahead and create it? You can go to service applications. You can go and say secure store service, and that will help you to create a token ID. The ID that you create there, you will have to give it to here. Now, one issue that you see here, I think this session is more like telling you what are the issues available when you don't have internet. So one issue that you see here is more like when you install a SharePoint 2010 sandbox, you can say that directly include my corporate credentials for all the administration rights onto the system. What helps in that is once you do that, you can try to explore all the social net media features, all the social interaction features, tagging, blogs, wikis, all that which is new. So people usually try to add that component. Once that is added, every time you want to validate a user, you would need to be on that corporate network or you would need to RAS into that corporate network. So that's when you can go and create your tokens and token IDs, etc. So that once you create that token ID, on the SharePoint designer, you can give your token ID here and then it is straightforward. You would get all your databases visible just as you saw it here. You can go open up the databases from the designer. You can create CRUD operations. You can create a list and bind that list onto your SharePoint portal. In SharePoint designer, yes. Yes, it was not there in 2007. So that was the hosted data we saw. And the custom service, how you write your .NET client object model, that is the third approach. So finally, in terms of summary, points of integration, I just wanted to call that once more to say that if you're looking at using Windows Azure, you can points of integration using client object model, VCS, Silverlight. So these are the various client object, various points of integration that you can use. Now, good point to start is go to microsoft.com/Windows Azure. That is your one-stop shop for Windows Azure. Once you go there, you can get access to all the components that I spoke about, case studies. There is a separate section for SharePoint there. You can go there. It will ask you to create your virtual machine and download the Azure specifics for your SharePoint. So you can do that and then you can get started.